used in recent weeks. And of course, this is the most talked about team composition in European LCS right now.
There was already a lot of criticism when it came down to Fnatic's drafting, but this one last week, game one against H2K, we kind of, it was when people had enough. It was like, this is just too terrible because they had losing lanes across the board and a Kha'Zix who couldn't do anything. You know, Syndra would push in the Jace, Malco would get pushed in by Nautilus, bot lane with the Braum. They lost every lane and they lost this game so, so fast. They were like, not able to do a damn thing.
Yep.
And then you have to criticize the draft. This is obviously from Unicorns of Love's side where we can see it's not that unique. Like, these are standard meta picks, except for maybe like a Trundle top lane, but he's still fairly common.
Yeah, exactly. So, and of course, this graphic you're seeing at the bottom of the screen is just to give a little bit more context. Unicorns playing the meta picks, playing the more standard, and we need to see if they can continue to up their game, because UOL peaked very early in the splits, and then they lost a bunch, and now they need to climb back up.
We're just trying to kill the storyline that they only play cheesy stuff or unique picks. They have very standard things they bring to the table, and as a team, as you said, they peaked very early. I want to see them bounce back. I think they're still a better team than Fnatic on paper, but you still got to show it in the BO3, because Fnatic, they're hungry. Jesus was tweeting earlier how he felt like practice was going the right way now for them. They finally really figured out what to do as a team. So let's see if it works on stage.
Well, we're going to find out. We have talked a lot about the pick and ban theory for these two teams. Let's jump through what we've missed. No huge surprises. Varus first pick, the Jhin reply. Rengar open for Xerxes. Over the Graves, for example. Ryze for Exile as well.
I mean, leaving Varus open is a bit of a surprise. He's really considered the S-tier AD carry right now, but you can trade him for other things. That's what Unicorns did here. Still think it's a bit risky because he's so, so strong. Mid lane bans because they have the Ryze pick, trying to set up Exile for success. Caps is the kind of player, though, who has a massive champion pool. He's very confident in a lot of different matchups, so he's very hard to ban out. And that's why these bans, you know, while they're fine from the Unicorns, they might end up, you know, not being too useful if Caps still feel like he has three or four strong picks left to play.
All right, Caps is another guy we will talk more about as this series plays out, because he's been an interesting player. Yes. Some explosive games, some disappointing games. And now it's time for Fnatic to start rallying as a team. It's week 7, they're running out of opportunities to climb up the table and get as high a seed as possible getting into playoffs.
I think with this Zyra pick here, Unicorns are really building towards like this very strong 2v2 bottom lane, and then probably something like, you know, a very standard tank up top lane against Nautilus. Chachi is the kind of guy though who can play split push, like we've seen different picks like Trundle and Gnar from him. But I still think when you have this strong of a bot lane here, you have already a winning lane, you can just pick a normal tank and have a very strong team fighting comp.
Right, team fighting comp for UOL. Go figure, the one thing they've done exceptionally well all split long. The Karma locked in for Jezzes. This will be the 5th time he's run that champion. His most played, currently 2-2 on the split. He'll be comboing the Varus. There's a lot of pokes and frustration to deal with. Just a reminder really quick, as Victor's locked in for Caps, Orianna is disabled due to that bug from yesterday. It is not going to be available at all in the European LCS, and it's just going to be a top lane pick for Chachi, the Trundle. So nothing really surprising here. Maybe just that Varus first pick you've already mentioned.
Yeah, leaving that one open. Very standard comp from Fnatic. Much better draft from Fnatic, we have to highlight. If we can criticize them, we can also praise them. And this is just a very, like, simple comp. Like, it's team fight based, it's a ton of wave clear. Like, your jungler adds wave clear, your support adds wave clear as well to your mid lane and AD carry. So it's a Fnatic comp that's going to be hard to kind of break through. It's going to be hard to kind of snowball on them simply because they have so many ways of stalling out the game, getting to the late game, and then they run with this tank and the shields from Akama. So very, very good. On the other side, from Unicorns, we're going into split push. It's not the traditional pure team fight. Trundle, split push, Ryze, split push, and then Rengar hovering around one of these side lanes, creating that one pick that really opens up the game for the Unicorns of Love. So, not the same kind of comps, very different win conditions. Last time we saw Unicorns play split push champions, they didn't really get the split push part and just kind of walked mid and said, let's fight with these champions, and it didn't work.
Hey, Unicorns are very well versed at fighting, right? So it's a difficult mindset to break out of.
But like Trundle in a team fight, just kind of running at people, it's just like, it's not very useful.
Well, we're going to find out how good Fnatic can be in team fighting, because the champions, they're locked in. Players loading onto the Rift. It's time to get into game one between Fnatic and the Unicorns of Love.
Woo! Yeti gets stopped up, Scout of the Weekend. Xerxe flashing auto! Oh boy! Xerxe!
And it's game one between Fnatic and the Unicorns of Love. Let's see how these two teams bounce back in the mid-split. Unicorns were undoubtedly the second-best team in Europe for a little while, and now those question marks have grown more and more over the last 3 weeks, as H2K and Misfits have kind of now overtaken them somewhat in perception. And Fnatic, they've not even been in discussion.
No, not at a single point in this split, actually. They have some Fnatic fans. It's actually funny, we got the Fnatic fans on one side, Unicorns of Love fans on the other side. No one is a fan of the Carsters, though, sadly.
They are indeed. They were fans yesterday at DeFisher, and it's about the teams today.
That's true.
So let's keep ourselves on the focus. I want to look at Caps and Exile, by the way, because Caps has got a slightly more safe style of mid laner in this Victor. Wave clear, scaling, not the hugest of outplay potential. Whereas Exile on that rise, he does. The reason I talk about that, in terms of both of these mid laners, Caps is actually first in the league for securing solo kills. He's managed to pick up 12 of those. Whereas Exile, on the other hand, he's secured 11. So it's number one and number two in the league.
And I think we looked at this and we were like, man, this is going to be explosive around the mid lane, because both of them get so many solo kills but also die quite often in these 1v1 situations. If one of them gets the advantage, they're not going to sit back and not do anything with it. They're going to try and really push it to the limit. And sometimes they push a little bit too far, but that's what creates like exciting 1v1s. Obviously, yes, as you highlighted, Victor is not the biggest, like, hey, I'm going to just get super fed and then outplay everyone. But a strong Victor performance can win you team fights basically on its own. So there's enough here for Caps to really have a lot of impact in this game. He will have to accept that his skirmish potential against the Ryze Rengar combo is not as strong, not as insane early on, but he's going to offer some consistency, he's going to offer wave clear, and then of course his scaling on this Victor is fantastic.
Hey, consistency, there's a word we've not said at Fnatic this split.
And Caps and consistency don't really fit there together either. You know, Caps is kind of like, I'm either 10-0 or 0-10, also in the laning phase, which has been a traditional rookie split. In many ways, honestly. Like, he's a good player. That's why he can get the 10-0s. But he's also a rookie who has a team that's been struggling. That's why he can get the 0-10s.
Talking about a team that's been struggling and Caps being the rookie, you know, until Broxah, you know, Soaz, Reckless, Jezzes, these are all very seasoned, very veteran players. And at the beginning of the split, along with Amazing, Fnatic, maybe the expectation should have been to try find ways to enable Caps to bring out his skills and stabilize that performance. And truthfully, we've just not seen them utilize this young talent.
It's just been the Fnatic story, lacking like a clear play style or identity. It's been a lot of like, maybe we should play around bot lane. Okay, we tried that. Okay, next game, let's play around top lane. And now we're gonna try to play around mid lane. And it was never like fairly consistent in the way they did it. I do think, however, whenever they play tanks top, that's when we start seeing a better Fnatic. Soaz doesn't need a lot of resources. He can be impactful in teamfights. It's always been where he kind of shined a lot. Like, while Soaz has always been known for his, you know, crazy split push adventures, as a teamfighter, it's actually where he's been doing the best over, you know, multiple years. So him on a tank is really good. Him on a ward is not very strong.
Nope, not at all. And Brox, obviously, going to be chilling, hanging out. Vizachachi's going to be farming up safely. Pretty cheeky interaction there between the Pillar of Ice and the dredge line. Chachi's even going to interrupt the back just to stall even more time. You know, it's these incremental plays and just get into Brox's head a little.
I think it's fun though to see a game where the lanes are very even early. Like, a lot of power and actually a lot of them, like bot lane, the Karma Zyra matchup, Jhin, Varus, the two best AD carries as well, facing off against each other. Top lane, Nautilus always has a good early game, but Trundle will then take over later. Two junglers who wants to farm for level 6. Like, a lot of similarities in that way when it comes to the early laning. And it comes down to player skill who gets the advantage. And right now, Reckless and Jezzes are sitting there with a small CS advantage. Could also be from some of the plants they're killing, though.
All right, so we'll have to keep track on the item spikes and the gold differences as the game plays out. As Hillisang and Samix, of course, have been pushing very heavily. Xerxe was in the bottom lane. He cleared out that Krug camp from Fnatic, so that's giving him a small advantage temporarily as Caps gets Rune Prison in place. There's support from Broxah coming from the north. And just a reminder, we are playing on patch 7.4 So, Ryze's Rune Prison is still very strong. So, as he uses that Q to get safety, do his best Spider-Man cosplay. And Exile really trading aggressively, wanting to force Caps to play defensive.
It's what we talk about with Ryze, you know, very skirmish focus, wants to constantly take the trades. Victor, he just wants to sit back, shoot with the laser, apply Q with an auto attack. That's how he wants to trade early. Ryze wants to, like, run you down, basically. He wants to stay near you, keep firing away the overloads. Bruxer knows this, so he's around this lane here. There's a control ward in the brush, disabling the ward here. And he comes in.
All right, flash and exhaust available. Bruxer just alleviating some pressure, right? That's what this feels like to me.
Yeah, but how do you gank for Victor not even pre-6, early on? He doesn't give you any CC.
Smoke screen to hide the gravity field.
And then the other guy would just kind of stand in and be like, you know, I can't see anything, so I'm not moving, right?
I'm just trying to answer the questions. This is why I don't answer questions, I ask questions, okay? That's this dynamic.
I do like, though, if that's how you work as a person as well. If I turn off the lights, you just kind of stand still in the middle. Like,
yeah.
I'm not going anywhere.
No, it's not worth the risk. Everyone's afraid of the dark. There's problems in the dark. And things happen. But Unicorns handling themselves well in this early game. Xerxes getting close to 6. No real problems. I mean, there's nothing really to speak of just yet, despite a little bit of shenanigans in multiple lanes.
And it's where you start looking for very small victories. Like, you don't look for that big, oh, okay, here's an ace and a tower, great, game is over. You look for, like, small advantages. Did you force a summoner spell? Do you maybe have, you know, a gank setup where you have some CC, like in this situation here with the Root?
All right, Reckless has flashed already. Jesus flashes immediately after. Xerxes decides to jump back in. Battleroar is going to buy some time, but there's no summoners on Fnatic bot lane.
And that's where we get a small victory now for Unicorns of Love. No flashes for Reckless and Jesus. This means Xerxes can return. It also means now you have to respect that Chachi teleported in a few minutes, otherwise you're going to die. So summoner spells advantage for the Unicorns of Love, and now they have to use that. Because when you have these even early games where the laning phase is just kind of matched against each other, one small victory can snowball into something much, much bigger. If this means now that you get 2 kills bot lane against the no flashes or the no flash champions from Fnatic, well, Fnatic is not going to get anything in return. Nautilus is not random and just going to kill the Trundle then. So you might get a huge advantage if you are the Unicorns.
All right, so how quickly can they open that window of opportunity?
Well, we need that ulti for Xerxes. Coming up fairly soon from him.
A little while away, about a minute to go until it's available. Control wards should get cleared out here by Xerxes as he jumps onto that one.
And it might actually mean that Fnatic, once they finally get to recall, you can see in the bottom lane they haven't recalled yet, they might just swap to top lane and get out of this laning phase to avoid it. They're actually going for Hilly. Man, Hilly, why are you so far up?
Hillisang has no flash, remember, and first blood picked up by Reckless.
We talk about the small victories leading into something bigger. We talked about it being Unicorns punishing Fnatic's bot lane with no flash, but Hillisang was sitting there.
Again.
No flash.
Hillisang, all split long, has been on the front line, has been an initiating force for UOL, and maybe overstepping his bounds.
Yeah, and that's the thing, you know, it doesn't look that huge. He's just sitting in a side lane brush in the lane, and he dies, but he had lost all vision in the river. His AD carry was sitting back near the turret. Hillisang is sitting so far up in his brush without any information of the enemy jungler, without a flash. That is a big mistake, and Fnatic instantly walk down and say, you talk about small victories? Yeah, we'll take it. This is a pretty easy first blood.
Yeah, it goes to arguably the most valuable member at this stage of the game as well.
Yep.
Swifty's picked up Tia as well as that serrated Diuk for Reckless. So he's going to be able to apply even more pressure.
I like the German
Samix
there.
A little bit.
Diuk.
Throw it in there. Samix and Hilly now also going to be playing further. But like the problem is it sort of changes the context of that lane. Because now, even though Reckless and Jezzes are flashless, they have an item advantage, there's a sidestone already picked up, boots, etc., you know?
It still means Xerxes can go bot lane, because there still is no flash on these two guys. Karma, while she can offer shielding, she can't, like, disengage properly against CZ from Zyra, CZ from the Ryze, sorry, from the Rengar. So I want to see Xerxes return to bot lane, but good warning here from Fnatic. Very deep inside the jungle, spots him very early on, so he can't gank from this area here. If you look at the bottom side of the map with his vision toggle, it's all blue. It's just Fnatic controlling it. So Xerxes clearly wants to gank bot lane, as we talk about.
Yeah.
But this is just good vision from Jesus and the rest of Fnatic.
Okay, looking at teleports available for both Soez and Chachi as we catch a quick glimpse of the trade up top. Subjugate, not going to get used yet by Visit Chachi. As I say that, it does. Pillar of Ice this time around will be a gigantic traffic cone. Defensive flash from Soaz. Depth charge into the air. Chachi takes a couple of tower shots, but they trade ultimates and flashes galore.
Everyone using flashes early on. No kill for Chachi. Broxah might just jump over the wall. See if he can find something. There is no camps to be taken, though. He might just place a few wards, and that is about it. But it's also, again, a small little win. You get a bit more deep vision to find the Rengar.
I mean, great early game vision here from Fnatic. And all of that information with Broxah spotting out Xerxes means Xerxes not ganking bot lane. Reckless and Jezzers, their flashes are just about to come off cooldown. So that early advantage, that early aggressive play from UOL, not only did it not get punished, but because of the aggressive play, Hillisang was punished because of an ensuing mistake. And that's just allowing Fnatic to be in the driver's seat for now.
And just showing a difference between the two bottom lanes right here. Fnatic really respecting what could happen. Hillisang didn't respect that, and that's why he died. And that's how it is early on here. It's still not going to change a whole lot in this game. It was just a missed opportunity, more or less.
But isn't it a little bit indicative of the two teams? When we were preparing for this matchup, Tofisher, one of the things we were talking about is how Unicorns of Love do not necessarily play around Samux, and Fnatic do somewhat play around Reckless. Now, Fnatic, with this, you know, great late-game ADC, reliable teamfighter in Reckless, he's got First Blood, he's got an advantage, and, you know, obviously Samux playing this more utility Jhin is behind.
Yeah, to add on to that one, Samux is normally doing well in lane. His CSD at 10 is the highest in the league. But outside of lane, he's actually doing almost nothing compared to other AD carries. And we're talking about teamfights here. We're not talking utility-based, just pure teamfight damage. He's obviously adding utility. That's what he's giving to the team. He's creating picks with them. But pure damage? No. Reckless does give you that damage. He deals the most on his team, the most of the AD carries. So the fact that Reckless is now winning the early game, both in CS slightly, but has the one kill, should mean that he becomes more useful the further this game goes compared to a Samus. So we got to track that.
Yeah, we will be tracking that. You've been talking a lot about damage in Exile. You know, it really feels like he's playing quite aggressive, pushing forward over and over every time someone's nearby, dishing out those overloads. It feels like he's connected with every single one. And Unicorns, they've set themselves up at least some sort of vision-based play. No buff gonna get spotted, unfortunately. A little too late and not gonna overcommit into Fnatic's jungle.
No, Trev, we are waiting. We're waiting for Exile to be strong enough to play push. We're waiting for Chachi to use this big club of his to spank Soaz a little bit more.
So if Exile's going to be looking to split push, and Vezachachi is going to be looking to split push, and Fnatic don't really have a great answer to the necessary split push, what do these two teams do in the next 10 minutes? I mean, if Fnatic can stop UOL setting up, that's how they can prevent that, right?
Yeah, like one of the ways, obviously, is when you are playing with this Nautilus top lane here, when you get to, like, kind of just keep the wave even as for as long as possible, and if you ever get to push it out, like past the river, that's when you move, you roam, you leave the lane, just like expected in the last game G2 played. You leave, you go towards the mid lane, enemy jungle, you look for a team fight, you have Varus ult, you have the hook from Soaz to start these fights here. You don't just sit back in the side lane and let Unicorns push.
Right.
Then you will suddenly be under a lot of pressure and you can't do a whole lot. But before that happens, you should have openings to teleport, to roam, from these side lanes in to force these fights. Play around Dragon, play around Baron later. There are multiple objectives to play around for Fnatic. For now though, both teams are fine, just sitting and farming.
Oh. Unless a two-man route into a two-man knock-up, the curtain is called, the damage will drop Reckless and Jezzers low, and all it costs is a heal, and that chain of corruption preventing any further follow-up.
Well, it does force Fnatic back now, so Unicorns will get some damage on this bot lane tower. Once the minion arrives, it interrupts.
Ooh, Deadly Flourish can interrupt the back gravity field. Pulls Exile backwards. One of those overloads missed. The exhaust comes down as well. Caps has already ghosted. Flashes away the Q. Exile almost evening the ISO kills.
Caps playing into Exile's favor here. Doesn't want to take these trades normally, but Exile was just sticking around and Caps did the same. So now no flash. Broxah's bottom lane. Notice if he can do anything.
All right, Broxah in place
in case Xerxes
wants to come and play.
But now, Ryze can roam because they forced Caps back to base, so he has to return to get the wave in mid. Exile moving down with ulti.
Let's take a look what Exile can do. He's a little bit low on HP. This is risky. This is risky. But everybody's low. Reckless and Jezzes, they're split up. Broxa can't help. Jezzes is down. Unicorns decide to dive. Reckless gets dunked by Samux. Two kills, and it looks like Tower First Blood.
So Fnatic thought Exile was too low to really force this play, but then suddenly realized it's not about Exile. He's just there as a distraction. It's about the rest of the team already being there. Xerxes, who we highlighted, coming down towards the bottom lane, setting up that dive here. First tower, two kills for Unicorns. Great setup, and it all starts with Hillisang and Samux hiding in that rush, catching the Fnatic bottom lane, and then suddenly you can push in and set up this play.
Great turnaround for Unicorns of Love. Fnatic will get their first tower of the game. That still puts them in a gold deficit, and Broxa gonna get jumped on. Another big leap from Xerxes. Savagery used to chase forward in the bush. Jumps out one on one. Broxa goes down. Flash over the gravity field with the help of a curtain call. Cap should get dropped. Samux with another.
All right, we had nothing happening in this game just before, but Unicorns of Love, we get into the mid game and it all starts bot lane. Then boom, another kill in the mid lane. And now they catch Caps, who, remember, took that trade against Exile, were forced to flash away, and therefore died right after. So Unicorns really taking a lot of these small wins early, and then they just snowballed them into more and more kills. What a huge swing in gold.
And decisive gameplay from Unicorns of Love. Zero hesitation. Obviously, when Broxa walks into your jungle, that's easy, but looking at the setup in this tower dive.
Yeah, clearly they feel like Exile is not ready to actually dive them, otherwise they would just left. They had like a ton of time to walk away from this bottom lane. They stayed around, then Exile joins with Xerxes. Chachi even TP'd in just to say hello. Didn't really get to do anything, but Unicorns of Love got the summoner's advantage, got the HP advantage as well, and then used that to now pick up four kills, two towers, and they're going for the third tower within, what, 2 minutes?
Yeah, exceptional. All outer towers down. It looks like Fnatic might be setting their sights on that Ocean Drake, but it's such a small, small objective.
Oh yeah, this, like, it's nothing in return to what Unicorns are getting. Like, I don't think I've seen three outer turrets drop in this short amount of time. Unicorns of Love just using this advantage perfectly. They didn't get the tower quite yet, but Source has to respect that he might get dove by like four members of Unicorns.
Yes.
And he backs away.
All right, so is he going to be able to make it back to his inner turret? Flash is available, as is his teleport, very, very shortly. The tower's still not fallen, so this has bought enough time for at least Reckless and Jezzes to take down bottom. Broxa survives for a few seconds, decides to go back in, trying to help out Caps. The Chaos Storm and the Siphon Power, that gets a kill. Rune Prison into Overload. Now Soez is joining the fight. Exile looks to get rooted. There's no Flash to escape. It's a little messy, but it's Reckless that shuts him down.
So in the end here, 2-for-2, and now Fnatic pushing mid lane. Every single time someone gets a kill in this game, they seem to be able to get something more. Unicorns taking Rift Herald, that's great for Chachi, can be huge in the game, and they're okay trading mid-tower for it. Could have just stopped doing it and walked to mid lane to prevent this from happening, but they traded for it. Hillisang!
Alright, flash from Hilly gets the flash from Reckless. That could prove vital in the next few minutes. Let's see where Reckless decides to plant himself. There's no mid-tower to just stand and wave clear in front of, so this will complicate Fnatic's decision-making.
Yeah, because now, Trevor, we have very long lanes. Let's take a look at this skirmish. Exile with the aggressive ulti, get Brox at first. It's a 2v2. We said this before in the game, how the Rengar Rise 2v2 skirmish is stronger. And they use it to get two kills, obviously because Fnatic was on the bottom side.
Yeah.
Join first, pick up the kills, and I think Unicorns are happy with this because they get Rift Herald buff for Visicharchi. And the reason I highlight that is because he's obviously a pure split pusher on this trundle, or he should be. And now with these really long lanes, because there's so many outer turrets down pre-20 minutes, it's perfect for a 1-3-1 comp, because now Trundle can chase Nautilus down a long lane. Ryze can chase Victor down a long lane, and that's exactly what those two champions want to do.
And if anybody's ever running away and not quick enough to get away, Xerxes will catch them and kill them.
Yes.
Xerxes on this Rengar, by the way, has played twice this split. Currently 2-0. League-wide, Rengar is 9-4. But this has been a pretty good Rengar performance. You know, he hasn't necessarily needed to do a huge amount with his ultimate, but he's been with the team, yep. Responded effectively, and is setting plays up as a unit.
Fnatic got caught a little bit with the pants down. Felt like they were like, oh, this is a slow early game, we got a scaling comp, this is nice, this is comfy, exactly what we're looking for, and bam, bam, bam. Three kills happen for Unicorns, and suddenly the game is wide open, and now Fnatic playing into this very high-tempo Unicorns of Love team. They haven't been able to match it just yet. That's why they're down 3K gold.
3K gold and a tower and three kills. And looking at some of the item differences as well, Rod of Ages as well as Abyssal Scepter for Exile, Eye Edge and Ghostblade for Samus in 20 minutes. He's going to hit like a truck.
Yeah, people might wonder why now Edge of Night. Well, the Infinity Edge is a better build for killing tanks, and he has this big fat Nautilus in his face, so he needs to be able to take him down. That's where the Eye Edge comes in. Generally also just great for burst. When you know you're going to get that guaranteed crit, don't need to amplify it too much, but he most likely will get like a rapid fire cannon as well in this build, just to get even more crits from this Jhin here. And we mentioned the long lanes, yeah. Champions who liked it. Jhin is another champion who loves the long lane because he's ulti, such a long range, he's W. So when you have no tower to hide at, every time you walk out near the river, you're kind of afraid. You're like, oh, is he going to like snare me? He's going to ult me from here? Am I caught out? And then suddenly you get jumped.
Well, I mean, it's the, oh, Chain of Corruption just short. Xerxes in Exile able to back away quickly enough. And you know, the Captain Obvious statement, this is the early game that Unicorns were looking for. They've opened up the map. They've got their Ryze in a good position. Visachachi's out farming Soaz by a fair margin. He's starting to build some tanky stats as well. All right, now Unicorns, now we start judging you on how well you play the split push. Do you set up a 1-3-1, or does everyone just hang out in the mid lane and hope Fnatic pushes?
Yeah, I don't want to see them just hang out in the mid lane. I actually want to see Chachi stay in this side lane for as long as possible. He has a lot of, you know, pressure on the Nautilus. His tower damage is just fine. You know, he can buff his own attack speed when he's near that turret. Just basically chunk it down fairly quickly. But I think if you're Chachi, he's kind of being like, I need a second or third item before I feel confident sitting under tower with Source next to me, taking it down. But he's strong enough to just be a pure split pusher. He doesn't need to join mid lane. Because all Fnatic wants to do is 5-on-5. And if Fnatic is never allowed to 5-on-5, their composition doesn't work.
Yeah.
So we don't want to see Chachi opt into this. Stick to your side lane. Put full pressure. And then get these second, these tier 2 towers down.
And Hillisang, do not get caught out.
Right.
Now, when I think about a lot of the Unicorns games at this stage, you know, the 20 to 30 minute mark, when they do kind of devolve a little bit to that ARAM style, single lane focus, Hilly, he wants to make plays. He's trying to set something up. You know, it's not like an Xpeke where he gets caught out of position without maybe a goal, but Hilly's trying to make a play, trying to get a root, trying to set up CC. He's done it on a number of champions over the last few weeks.
I think it's important
frontline again.
Of course.
Support's coming up, though.
It's important to highlight, though, that Hillisang in this comp is actually not that important. Like, he doesn't need to make a play because you're winning by pushing three lanes at once. It's not about him flash rooting someone and then starting a team fight. It might happen in the game, but that's not how they're supposed to win. So it should be the kind of game where he can sit back and not risk it too much. This is the kind of trades we're going to see where Soaz can't do a damn thing.
No, and look at the tower. Soaz is going to try fall back. And Chachi can just continue to pressure him over and over. Unicorns continuing to extend that gold lead, continuing to push their advantage even further forward.
Yeah, and because Chachi is pushing so far forward, because he's sticking to that side lane, as we talked about, it opens up for the river. That means dragon, that means baron. Like, this is a free dragon for Unicorns of Love. There's nothing Fnatic can really do to stop it. That is going to be a baron in 5 minutes. And then Fnatic has to blindly face check the Baron, because every lane is getting pushed down by this Unicorns comp.
And officials, those types of plays that explain the average gold lead for Unicorns, jumping from plus 500 gold at 20 minutes to around plus 2,500 gold at 25 minutes. You know, it spikes, it jumps very, very quickly.
And also, like, you start taking away camps. Like, notice how Chachi is farming the bot lane. He's also farming the bot side jungle at the same time, so he's literally taking stuff away from Broxa, taking stuff away from Soaz, his tower very soon, and there's no one who's stopping him. The only way you can stop him is Fnatic sends two or three guys to kill him, but then Unicorns should be able to get a tower or a Baron.
All right, tower or Baron for Unicorns of Love. That's where they're going to set their sights on. Fnatic just need to combat Vision, need to try and clear out some of the wards that Unicorns have pushed into the jungle, and let's go back to these team fight styles, right? Fnatic have worked a lot around Reckless in the past.
Oh, good little sneak into the Baron pit. This is not spotted by Fnatic. Two members from Unicorns are sitting in mid lane to kind of bait the whole situation, saying, no, we're totally not doing Baron. You know, we're right in front of you. And now when Baron is low enough, they run back in to secure it. Great play.
Such great play. Zero risk. And there's even a realm warp to safety.
Too early.
Samix had to finish that one off. Sheepy is as surprised as we are.
Chachi, you're supposed to run now because you just took Baron.
Okay, flashes away from the Chain of Corruption. Tagged by a piercing arrow, the rest of Fnatic is coming down. There's a Chachi gonna buy some time. It looks like Caps will be able to run him down. Where's the CC? Not gonna connect. There's a Chachi, he's gonna go low. Teleport's interrupted!
Joke's on you, Chachi. We nerfed Teleport. Takes longer to channel. That was now, it was a 10 out of 10. From the Unicorns of Love, became a 9 out of 10 because Chachi stayed for a little bit too long. He wanted that tower, but it's fine. What a great setup from them.
Does this make it a 9.5 if Samus can take the tower?
It's a 9.5.
And look at the clean rotation top. Wave has already been pushed in by Xerxes.
9.8.
Okay, so Chachi, you've cost a 0.2 on behalf of that Baron play?
On behalf of the perfect play.
There we go.
It was so close to the perfect play. It could have been Chachi just backed away. He wouldn't have died. Unicorns, they got the whole thing. But now they got a mid tower anyway, so very, very close. Like, just honestly, great setup. This is a Unicorns Olaf who's not getting caught out. Look at good guy Hillisan. Staying back, but like, yeah, boys, I'm not needed here. I'm not doing anything. And they just bait the Baron setup. They had full vision of everything because of the split push. And it all starts from them getting the four kills into three towers, and then using 1-3-1. Love it.
And this is such an important game for the Unicorns of Love. They are currently tied with H2K in series win-loss at 6-2 in Group B. And of course, Unicorns, they're playing Fnatic today. H2K are playing Misfits, an arguably much stronger opponent tomorrow. And depending on those results, we can see who could hold control of first in the league right now.
Trying to fight in mid.
We'll talk about that a little bit later. Samix gets tagged by the piercing arrow, so as no flash available. And 1-3-1. Unicorns successfully repel Fnatic's attack, get two towers, and are making great use of this Baron buff.
And now I know a lot of people are going to be like, oh, Fnatic drafting defensively. It's passive. You can't force anything in this game. It was looking just fine for them. Yes, that is the risk when you run this comp. There's a risk to every comp. The risk for this one is if you start falling behind, you're purely team fighting, you're purely wave clear. You can't really force plays very easily, and then it can look really bad.
Yep.
But it was dead even at first. It was looking just fine for them, and then they actually got outplayed. The bot lane 2v2, that was an outplay by Unicorns. Exile's 1v1 against Caps, that was an outplay by Exile. So those plays set Unicorns up for success, not Fnatic's comp being bad or anything.
So Samix and Hilly in a 2v2, the engage of the ulti, allowed Xerxes and Exile to outplay Broxa and Caps and make plays individually, just performing a little better, but then as a team, they're utilizing those advantages.
Exactly. Right,
that's the next step that Unicorns are putting on the Rift, and so far, the 1-3-1, I mean, 9 out of 10? What do you think of that?
Oh yeah, it's great so far. They've been doing everything correct. Like, that's the thing. They're getting all the outer turrets. They've been getting Baron. Now's the point where I can slow down a little bit because breaking into the base is very hard. It's very easy to kind of move between the two or three inhibs here. Like, very short path you have to defend if you're a Fnatic. So that's when you wait for another Baron. You wait for, you know, one or two Drakes more. In this case, only one. And then you use that second Baron you pick up to try and re-break into the base.
If there is one advantage for the Fnatic squad, now that Baron buff has worn off, Graves, Victor, Karma, Varus.
Farm three lanes,
now
baby.
Now you can stall. Now you can stall. But the problem is, there is now no more room for error at all, right? Fnatic cannot give up another Baron. Fnatic cannot give up another tower, because that just gives Unicorns another, like, lever to pull and to squeeze to look towards the Nexus.
And luckily for Fnatic, they got plenty of time. Like, they have to break the 75 minutes of yesterday for us to kind of be unhappy with it.
Oh yes.
For now, they can just wave clear three lanes for about, you know, what should we say, another 40 minutes. We already practiced. We're ready. We've seen it all.
We've got this. The benchmark is set.
Okay. We can turn on the fun, the banter, at any point.
Listen, Fnatic owns the longest game in EU LCS history record.
That's a with Origins. Games.
80 minutes and 28 seconds, if I recall correctly. That's what we said yesterday. So come on, break that record. It's could be one of those weekends. I don't think Unicorns are going to give them that opportunity, though. You can see Unicorns gathering around this Drake.
I kind of also feel like Unicorns is slightly better at closing out the game than Origin and Rocket. So kind of goes in Unicorns' favor.
I think that's pretty fair. I think that's a fair statement. You know?
I'm only trying to make safe statements right now.
Okay.
I want to make sure everyone sitting at home is kind of nodding, being like, yeah, I agree. I definitely agree.
That's one of them.
I think Unicorns is ahead in this game as well.
Especially with that Mountain Drake.
Especially Mountain Drake's great. You know,
what I do like about that, though, is Elder Drake's going to be at about 36 and a half minutes, around there. So it's a slightly earlier Elder Drake that could be for the taking. And with Unicorns having such absolute map control, Fnatic need to push through so much darkness in their own jungle, in their own half of the map.
Fnatic needs to farm long enough to make gold irrelevant in the game.
Yeah.
So it's never fun to be in that situation where you're like, yeah, okay, we have to wait another two or three items because they won't get any map control. They're going to rely on Unicorns kind of really butchering like a fight near a Baron or something. So this is typically where you look at a game and say, this should now be so heavily in one team's favor that they should win the game, no matter what. But in sports, in esports, we do see mistakes. We do see like what we call throws, obviously. And that's where stuff can still go wrong. But Unicorns in full control.
Okay, Unicorns in full control, just off screen. Reckless flash engaged with Chain of Corruption. Samok's response flash got him to safety. It ends up being a kind of even trade, right? Both ADCs are flashless. But it doesn't result in, again, it still means Fnatic are 8,000 gold behind. And Reckless. Maybe feeling the pressure, maybe.
I mean, that's the thing, you know.
Feeling like he needs to make something happen.
Fnatic right now, they're hoping for like a Patriots versus Falcons moment. They're hoping for a Barcelona versus PSG moment. There's an NBA reference here somewhere as well, but I don't really follow NBA, so I kind of forgot that one. But they're hoping for that big upset, big surprise, big comeback. Xerxes, though, he's looking for some kills.
He is at the moment, currently invisible for now. Thrill of the Hunt just spotting out where possible, has the potential to flank and turn around. Soaz gets prisoned in place. The bomb's gonna at least knock up Senkax. Here comes the Realm Warp, gonna deliver Unicorns of Love into Fnatic's hands. Defensive flashes and the collateral to buy some time. Brox is getting tagged by the Call of the Curtain and Caps is running for his life. Fnatic lose two.
There we go, Unicorns of Love finally gets the kills. Now they also get the inhibitor. The inhibitor in the mid lane. The brain stopped working for a second again.
Well, get the tower, get the inhib. They've got supers, a 10,000 gold lead, and just another fantastic decision. Decisive from Unicorns of Love.
Yeah, the patience as well. It's like Xerxes sitting at the flank, you know, waiting.
You have to stop for a second. Patience. Unicorns of Love. I don't think that's a phrase we've used a huge amount.
Well, it's been a great game from them, so maybe it's time we start using it more because they're showing it here. Like, we have seen high tempo earlier. Now we see patience. Look at Xerxes here on the side, waiting. Then boom, as soon as Source gets caught, then he jumps in and he's just being annoying. He's not trying to kill anyone. He's just being so annoying in the back line. And then the rest of the team with a good Realm Warp can chase Fnatic down, get the mid lane inhib, and now the base is open, Trev, and that is a key thing for them against so much wave play.
So tough. Like, Caps actually almost, you know, sort of two-shot Hillisung. And the reason I mention that, if the game state were different and Fnatic were on a more even footing, this three-item victor could have been so much more terrifying into four fairly squishy champions.
But it's not, because and Unicorns of Love are playing some very good League of Legends using their comp.
Well, Soaz uses his ultimate, but there's not really a lot of support.
Is that a perk?
Reckless was trying to defend the super minions in the mid lane. And Xerxes still chilling with that Thrill of the Hunt.
I mean, he's applying a debuff, so Reckless is kind of like, okay, he's probably coming from topside. You have to respect it a little bit. But they're trying to now get another inhib down, because mid lane is not enough. You need a second one, and you have a Trundle top lane. Taking down that tower very easily. And it's one of those games, you know, where the Trundle, he's 1-1-2, so if you just see the score after the game, you don't really feel like he was impactful. But in the game itself, he's just been split pushing 24/7 and applying so much pressure.
Like this. Here's the Chachi wailing away on that inhibitor. Mid lane Obviously, down has been for a little while. Soez is going to be the target for now. Broxah rooted in place by the Flourish, while the rest of Fnatic are trying to defend the bottom lane turret. One of three remaining Unicorns playing this one by the numbers, trying to get all of the inhibs available to them. And Visit Chachi continues to apply the pressure.
With his army of minions, Soez is trying to catch someone. Playing Nautilus when behind is really a sucky feeling, though, because no matter what you do, you're just kind of diving in and you don't do a whole lot, you just die.
Yeah, definitely. Redemption's going to be used by Fnatic. The third and final inhibitor drops. Unicorns of Love set their sights onto the Nexus, and they are just ushering these Baron empowered super minions onto the turrets. This could be where Fnatic in 5v5, they've got Exile, they blow him up! Stranglethorns buys a little bit of time, allows Unicorns to escape. Hillisang almost gets chunked down as that death ray. So close. Fnatic, but that's a flash! Reckless! Piercing Arrow gets the kill. The problem is...
They lost all inhibs.
They've got no inhibs. They've got double super minions for at least another 30 to 40 seconds.
Too little, too late, Trevor. Unicorns got everything they wanted because now they can walk down, take an Elder Drake. Double super minions coming in every single lane. Yes, Fnatic can farm more lanes and more minions. But that is really the only positive thing right here for them. Unicorns of Love been in full control. Basically been sitting on the throne for the entire game.
And that's what Unicorns are playing for. If they pick up a series win here, they will temporarily look to hold first place in Group B. Until we see what happens with Misfits and HTK tomorrow. It's the last week of cross-group play. This is currently number one, number two from Group B, taking on number three, the clear third-best team in Group A, Fnatic.
And it's still fun to kind of compare the two groups, like which group is the strongest. We see the fight, though, from before. Just root onto Exile, and then he instantly gets bursted down. So chain CC, and decent follow-up here, getting Hillsong down as well with the last one. Reckless. And flash. Boop. Sucks to be support sometimes. Luckily though, I think Hillsang is actually okay with that because the enemy AD carry just traded flash for a kill that, you know, didn't really do a whole lot, so.
Look at this, mid inhibitor just about to respawn. You can tell by the animation on your screen, and of course, Unicorn's already poised to take it down. Broxah, collateral damage to buy some time, and Exile's caught out once again. You can't make those mistakes at this stage, Exile. Piercing Arrow flies across the Unicorn squad. It's going to drop them low. Soez is as well. No GA, but the inhibitor goes down. Double supers refreshed. For now, it's a double-double. That's what Unicorns are looking for.
Oh, Soez teleporting behind. This might be the comeback.
No ultimate for Soez. Where's the support? Soez finds himself caught between a kitty cat and the rest of the Unicorns. Piercing Arrow chunks down Samux. Fnatic can't engage. Soez kind of left for dead. The shield buys some time. GA is popped from Visit Chachi, and Gravity Field means that he's going to get caught in place, but not going to get killed.
Have to remember, Fnatic are fighting against Elder Drake, so even with the kill on Exile, they can't just go and take down more members. Teleport used. Fnatic holding
to
the Fischio
base.
Hey, we gave them another 40 minutes. That's 20 now. This is the inhib. We're going down. Let's see Exile. Caught, snared, knocked up, simply just chain CC'd. Nice hook by Soez, and Exile, second time he's getting caught. So, we are actually just seeing Fnatic get, you know, triple farm right now, or double farm at least, with all the super minions. They will lose every other objective.
And right now, Unicorns, it's the final hurdle that they need to get past. But Fnatic and Unicorns of Love, two teams in the EU LCS over the last 2 years, that have been somewhat synonymous with crazy endings to games.
Yeah, we've been here quite a few times.
And not just the first time they met in the finals in spring 2015.
Uh-huh.
Regular season in summer the following year. Regular season last year.
Again, if people don't remember, we had the moment where Fnatic almost killed the Nexus twice, literally down to one hit. And then Unicorns managed to turn it around and actually beat Fnatic. It's one of those series where we were just screaming for
Deficio
ever.
That was Fnatic UOL, who have a history between themselves. 2-3 weeks ago, Unicorns couldn't finish the Nexus against G2. and failed at that final hit, and that allowed G2 to get the 2-0. Now, I only bring that up because if there was something to bring on post-traumatic stress disorder, losing two team fights in Fnatic's base might just trigger those feelings.
Or it might make the four members on Unicorns kind of yell at Exile and be like, dude, come on, just don't get hooked, and we're gonna win this. We had Elder Drake, calm down, we're fine, we get a Baron now. Like, it is effectively, Unicorns will love owning 95% of the map. It's been the same way for like, what, 15, 20 minutes almost?
Oh yes, oh yes.
Only thing Fnatic actually owns is the two Nexus turrets and the Nexus itself.
And the only real way for Fnatic to sort of bounce back here is UOL have to all overcommit and make mistakes. You know, you've seen Unicorns lose Exile a couple times, and despite being forced away, it hasn't meant anything for Fnatic. They've been locked inside their base.
Ooh, a little trap.
There's no bush to hide behind this time. No one's playing Ivern. Instead, they're just going to hang behind the wall. Knee-high cover. It's a console trick. Everyone's safe behind knee-high cover. Unfortunately for Soez, he gets tagged through it. Inhibits are on the bottom lane. Looks like it's going to go down to visit Chachi. He's got no Chie available of a fight where to break out. Soez reckons he's got a chance here as Exile and Hilly get forced away. Yeah, this thing's used those strangle thorns, but now it's starting to get messy. Soez's GA has popped. Xerxes and Vizachachi come up. Fnatic want to defend Soez's life. He's low. 1,000 HP. Exile drops him down. Soez is out. 5 versus 4. Vizachachi's looking to re-engage his caps. Throws down the siphon power on the death ray. Another inhib is the target.
Yeah, and rest of Unicorns of Love taking a lot of damage here. Poke landing from Reckless. So Fnatic will have to see two inhibs fall. The bottom one, mid one is already down. Top one stays alive. Delays Unicorns of Love again. Delays the Baron again. And that is what happens when you draft like a turtle comp. And you get to sit with wave clear. We highlight this in champ select. There's wave clear from 4 out of 5 members on Fnatic. Even Karma adds some wave clear at this point. But Varus, Victor, and Graves. Like, unless you can actually get a kill, or let's say 2 kills in this case, using the super minions to actually break down the Nexus is difficult because you just have to respect how fast it can kill the waves.
Unicorns of Love, gonna try again. This is round 4.
Fight.
They've lost 2 fights. The previous one, I think you can say they won because Soez went down and they got the inhibitor.
It's been small fights.
Small fights, of course. But everyone was getting involved. Vizachachi's pulled backwards. Chachi can still use the subjugate to buy some time. Gravity field backwards, not gonna get a chance. Reckless is on a rampage.
Oh man, I was joking earlier, by the way, when I said Fnatic had like another 40 minutes.
Well, Fnatic are not joking, DeFisio, because they want to go another 40 minutes. They've not given up yet.
No, that's why we can't just call a game over, even when it's supposed to be. In this case here, with Fnatic's wave clear, Exile getting caught a few times, Source with some good engages, honestly, on this Nautilus. They have just been able to hold and hold and hold.
I was looking at the player cams a moment ago. Stressed, stressed faces on the side of Fnatic, and this was the engage from Soez onto Chachi. Again, great CC layering. I mean, it's easy with this much CC at times.
Right.
But they're making it work.
And we get to this point now where, again, this goal difference, it starts to matter less and less. We always talk about it. Right now, it's full build on Reckless, so he doesn't care about being behind 10k gold. Victor, almost sitting on full build, he doesn't care about being behind 10k gold either. And this is because Fnatic have been farming 3 lanes now, yes, for, again, such a long time. Unicorns are not getting anything extra on the map.
With an extra minion wave in most of them, thanks to those supers. 3 Guardian Angels on the side of Unicorns of Love. Embrace the revive. Get an extra life. Exile gets caught once. He can come back. He can try again.
At some point, you use the GAs, you get a Baron buff, and then with their triple super minions, in this case, will only be obviously in 2 lanes they get the super minions and not the double ones, but they will get some. You honestly just try and rush it to the base and just go for the Nexus turrets. But Fnatic's comp, as we talked about, is so good in team fights that you can't, because like you have to respect late game Victor. You can't just walk by him. So it gets so difficult for them to push all the way in. You start needing like Banner of Command, one way to kind of stop caps from pushing in a little bit and put some more threat maybe on the bottom side, and then you're playing on the top side of the base.
I'm looking forward to those Banner the Commands and ZZ Rots. Fnatic could use them to help defend. I think Reckless being a full build, once he's got enough money to buy and resell and rebuy, we can unveil the EU's ZZ Rots that just sometimes appears. But for Unicorns, Elders in a minute and a half, roughly. Baron's up a little bit after that. So they can also just wait for the big objectives and try use those to finish. The problem is, they didn't use the previous ones effectively. So they need to change their approach, right? Be a little more patient, be a little more controlled.
I mean, one of the things we don't actually see teams do, but might be an option if you simply can't break down the base is, you know, you wait for both buffs to be alive, and then you take one, go to the other one. In this case here, they can do it because they spawn pretty close to each other. But when you have Baron buff, Elder Drake buff, full build, GAs, you should be so strong that you can brute force your way into the base. And if you can push them back to the Nexus turrets, you can burst those towers down fairly quickly.
Yeah.
So in this situation now, Unicorns can get both buffs, which is really, really good for them. They can take the Elder Drake, walk over, take the Baron, and they don't have to delay anything.
The first time in about 12 minutes, Fnatic can see the river.
Oh, there's
gonna... Scryer's Bloom has revealed the river. Soez is in the river. It's a whole new world, and what can Fnatic do with it? All right, looking at the minimap, Xerxy could come in from behind Fnatic. Teleport is available for Chachi. He's sitting on it now. Fnatic are looking to force something.
Yeah, it's always scary in new territory here. You don't know what's lurking behind you, where the enemy can suddenly come from. And Fnatic running as a group, five man together, bunch of explorers.
Thrill of the hunt.
For resources, they're gonna find something.
Soez, Pillar of Ice, does not lock him down. Xerxy's got a lot of time to dawdle and deander in that invisibility, stepping forward again. Now it's gonna slowly time. Pillar of Ice again from Chachi. It's not locking anyone down.
No, but this is where Fnatic wants to be.
Fnatic have started the fight. Stranglethorn's gonna knock up three. What can Unicorns do? GA has popped. There's two more to burn through. Xerxes has popped as well. Fnatic, they're winning the fight. Unicorns are running away. Xerxes caught. Xerxes killed. Reckless is unstoppable. Reckless wants to go godlike. Jez is running onto the front line. No more CC to work with just yet. Deadly Flourish doesn't root Fnatic, and at 47 minutes in a 10,000 gold deficit, Fnatic win the fight.
Forget the last 25 minutes. Fnatic now are dead even, maybe even stronger with the comp.
Not done yet, no GA or Chachi. He flashes away. All of a sudden, now Hilly's caught in the back end. Soez and Caps, they drop him down. Elder is up, Baron is up. Fnatic kill Exile. They can take what they want.
They've been farming and farming and farming. Full items, team fighting calm, late game. Unicorns of Love had such a good mid game, but who the hell cares when we're now 48 minutes into the game? And Fnatic, they're winning.
They're gonna take down the inhibitor. Soez is teleporting in for this one. 40 seconds for Exile, 30 for Hillisang. Deficio, they're going for the win. Samax,
chance out. Super Bowl all over again.
Oh my word, here comes Xerxy. The gravity field stuns them out. Flash into collateral damage. Samax can't escape. Chachi's trying to do what he can, but it's 1-on-5. Fnatic, how the hell did you turn that one around? From more than 10,000 gold with no inhibitors, Fnatic beat the Unicorns.
The game is never over. The Nexus has to die first. And the Unicorns of Love, they walked into a wall again and again and again. We talked about the wave clear. We talked about the scaling. Unicorns got caught out multiple times when they were still so far ahead on items, when they were so strong. It just delayed the game. It delayed it again and again and again, and suddenly we get to this point where it's full items on
both
teams.
It doesn't make sense.
Take your 10k gold lead, throw it away. It doesn't matter because now everyone has everything they need.
I'm not being funny, but the Unicorns of Love have a real Nexus killing problem. Like, this is... There's so many other aspects of the game that are getting better and better. In the case of 3 weeks, inhibitors down in the base and just...
The Baron setup, it was great.
The Baron was beautiful. The follow-up, the towers, the power play. and the final hurdle, they tripped and hit their head so hard.
They ran straight into the wall.
So hard.
Straight into the wall. And Fnatic just benefited. You know, they farmed champions, they farmed minions. They didn't need any dragons, they didn't need any barons. Who cares? They just needed one last, you know, team fight that gave them a kill. And then they chased that into more kills.
One more team fight, right?
Well, they chased that into the next fight. Yeah,
exactly, because Unicorns kept giving them fight after fight after fight. And it's like,
man,
do you know, these games, while they are like super entertaining, they just give you more questions than they do answers. Because Unicorns, I didn't expect their early game to look as good and as clean. And then I saw the split push and I'm like, ooh, how well will it get set up?
Pretty well.
And they made me sit down and shut up. But then the final push.
It didn't happen, man.
Fnatic snatched game one in this best of three over Unicorns for a closer look at how it went down or how the Unicorns